for it. It's going to be, you know, the ruling establishment has a lot of, they will stop at nothing to complete their toolkit of control, right? So one of the things that has been missing from the toolkit of total control has been quarantines and curfews, right? Mm-hmm. So now, welcome to the new world in America where you will be able to get on a bus, to go through a subway station. If you think that the procedures at the TSA are onerous and a little bit excessive, right? Guess this is coming to a bus depot near you. This is coming to it's a more invasive way, and the ruling class needs this, because if the ruling class ever saw wide-scale civil unrest, you'd see an Ebola outbreak in America right away. Now, one of the things I'd like to show to back up my my claims here, here's a document from the Rockefeller Foundation. Rockefeller Foundation right there. You can zoom in on that where my finger is. It's called Scenarios for the Future of Development and International Development, the Rockefeller Foundation. All right? Okay, let's take a look at what they're saying here. This is something like a 50, 60-page document. I'd like you to go to page 18 if you can look at this up on the internet, but I'll read it off to you. It's called lockstep, lockstep. And this is a phrase that I used right after 2001 when I saw the entire system of the United States, including the population, were in lockstep. So the Congress went along, and yes, it was Osama bin Laden, and the people waved their flag and said, I hate, 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 and everything was in lockstep. Well, in 2010, they published this, Rockefeller Foundation, and here's what they're saying. They're saying that they call it a scenario. These are scenario narratives, and they speak about it in the past tense. So they put out this scenario, lockstep. A world of tighter, top-down government control and more authoritarian leadership with limited innovation and growing citizen pushback. Okay, I'll read a little bit of it. In 2012, the pandemic that the world had been anticipating for years, nobody was anticipating a pandemic, finally hit. Unlike 2009's H1N1, this new influenza strain originating from wild geese. They use some scenario, but this is Ebola they're talking about. Ahead. Even the most pandemic-prepared nations were quickly overwhelmed when the virus streaked around the world, infecting nearly 20% of the global population and killing 8 million in just 7 months. The majority of them healthy young adults. The pandemic also had a deadly effect on economies. You can see the agenda, just naked, raw, naked control agenda written down, and it's anybody's guess how this becomes effectuated in real life. So whether this is written specifically as marching orders or whether people take it upon themselves in the intelligence networks to say, okay, well, this has been produced, so this is the plan here. But these narratives have to be written in advance because the intelligence agencies don't know how to do this, these narratives. They need help. So these think tanks, they come up with these, like Rand Corporation, Rockefeller Foundation. These are think tanks of death. They're not the think tanks. They're not there to find great ways to help people. Okay, the pandemic also had a deadly effect on economics. International mobility of both people and goods screeched to a halt, which is what they want. They want a completely isolated world, right? Debilitating industries like tourism and breaking global supply chains. Well, of course they want tourism. They want you stopped because they're not in the tourism business, and they want you at home in your house in front of the TV. Then they got you, because once you watch the TV, they own your soul. Even locally, normally bustling shops and offices sat empty for months. Okay, so I love how they talk about it in the past tense in 2010. The pandemic blanketed the planet, though disproportionate numbers in Africa died. Southeast Asia and Central America, where the virus spread like wildfire.
It sounds like the opening monologue of a disaster movie, right?
Exactly.
Over the opening credits as they show the disaster.
Sure. And they made it real.
They have something like this, a narration like this over the credits that sets you up.
Now listen, here's the good stuff now. But even In developed countries, containment was a challenge. Now, here's this one. I love this one. The United States' initial policy of strongly discouraging, in quotation marks, strongly discouraging citizens from flying proved deadly in its leniency. Proved deadly in its leniency. So they should have been tougher, right? Accelerating the spread of the virus, not just within the United States, but across borders. However, a few countries did fare better. China, in particular. The Chinese government's quick imposition and enforcement of mandatory quarantine for all citizens, as well as its instant and near hermetic sealing off of all borders, saved millions of lives, stopping the spread of virus far earlier than in other countries. So the message is here is we have to look towards the Chinese, the oppressive totalitarian Chinese regime, as an example of what we need to be doing here. And of course, the ruling class here loves the Chinese regime because they have demonstrated to the ruling class the most efficient form of capitalism, which is authoritarian capitalism. So we have capitalism, but unfortunately we have this veil.
I get it.
We have this veil of democracy.
This is very interesting. This is continue on. Please.
Okay. China's government was not the only one that took extreme measures to protect its citizens from risk and exposure. During the pandemic, national leaders around the world flexed their muscles, flexed their authority, and imposed airtight rules and restrictions. You can see the agenda.
Go.
Okay. From the mandatory wearing of face masks to body temperature checks at the entries to communal spaces like...
That's what's happening right now.
But soon it's going to be body,
It'll be at the subway?
Yeah.
Is that what you're saying? We'll be going through this in the subway, to get on the buses and the subway?
Absolutely.
Things
positively.
Like that.
And what this means, though, is, don't think about having a cigarette, a joint on you, basically, you can't... This is a dragnet for everything. So if in order for you...
Oh, in other words, just like with stop and frisk, this is ultimate stop and frisk.
This is cavity search kind of thing. All right, so during the pandemic, national leaders around the world flex their authority. Now, there's some good stuff. Listen to this. And even supermarkets, they want body checks at supermarkets. Okay, so basically what they're saying is they're building a system where... Every move you make,
you've got to
go through them.
Can't get food. If you go to the farmer's market?
Right. Here's the good stuff now. I mean, it just keeps getting better. Even after the pandemic faded, this more authoritarian control and oversight of citizens and their activities stuck and even intensified. That's the whole point. So they're going to get rid of...
Didn't that happen already with 9/11?
Of course.
9/11 was how many, 14 years ago? And we still have all these draconian rules.
So they're going to put the body cavity searches
Patriot
in.
USA, Patriot, and
that's
all
right. So in order to get to a supermarket, you got to have a body cavity search. And then when there's no more Ebola, you know what? We kind of like this way because we have an incomplete infrastructure of a control grid, like my friend down in Austin, Texas, Alex Jones says, control grid. Okay. And yes.
Alex Jones is a controversial figure.
Well, you may not like a lot of what he says, and I think that a lot of his stuff is a little bit, I think the way he delivers it, it can very much turn people off. However, he is hitting the salient points. Let's say. Now, even after the pandemic, in order to protect themselves from the spread of increasingly global problems, from pandemics and national terrorism to environmental crisis and rising poverty, leaders around the world took a firmer grip on power. Well, what the hell would rising poverty have anything to do with imposing strict citizen controls with face masks? So they're very sloppy stuff here. At first, the notion of a more controlled world gained wide acceptance and approval. I'm sorry. Nobody likes this stuff. I have to provide analysis.
We only have 5 minutes left, so that's...
Oh, my God. Okay. Citizens willingly gave up some of their sovereignty and their privacy to more paternalistic states in exchange for greater safety and stability. I mean, that's just a complete naked contradiction to the famous saying that if you think you're going to give up a little bit of your security, I mean, if you're going to give up your freedom for security, you're going to get neither. That's the long-standing thing. And here what they're doing is They're not even ashamed or embarrassed to absolutely say the exact opposite. They're saying, yes, we all want to give up our privacy and sovereignty for more stability and security and stability. So you don't get that. When you give it up like that, you get the shaft. That's right.
Okay.
We have the National Security Memorandum of December 10th, 1974. This is Henry Kissinger's brainchild. The National Security Memorandum number 200. You can look that up on your internet. I'll summarize it. He says that there's too many people. We got to get rid of the population. So if, to answer your question.
Oh, from earlier.
Yeah, he says he used the word depopulation, which is different. Depopulation means killing people that already exist, and it's to get the minerals. I guess the main thing to finish off this show is this, that they want to get more control, more curfew. And it's going to be curfews and quarantines. So what I'm saying is that unless the American people start to get some new way to revolt, a new way to organize, new way to protest, unless we can break through the apathy, because that's what we have here, then it's going to be a slave state here. The ruling class doesn't seem to have too much resistance. They're getting everything on their Christmas shopping list. And they've been wanting quarantines and curfews for a long time. Now they got it. And if you want to live in a world where you're tricked into all this stuff because it's for your safety, right? And if you want to have a probe and make sure you got to check your pockets, make sure you don't have anything incriminating on you before you go out. And when you step out of your house, you want some police there to monitor and see what you're doing. If that's the world you want to live in, be apathetic. Don't do anything. You're going to get that world very soon. It's coming your way, definitely.
Mm-hmm.